I stayed away from my old friends for a while. The psychiatrist seemed to want to help me. He suggested I take some mood balancing pills, so I bought some and tried them. The mood levels didn't make me feel any better, so I traded them in for some cocaine. I felt better for a little while, but it soon got worse. I began to fantasize a lot about my suicide. Something inside wanted me to live, so I talked to my doctor and he put me in a mental hospital for evaluation. I was detoxed, sent to a rehab center and attended my first NA meeting. Now I knew there was a way to stop. Recovery became a real possibility. Beginning to chip away at my guilt. Slowly but surely all my old excuses are losing validity. My life before NA earned me a jail term that I never received. I qualified for extended psychiatric care. My physical. 194 Narcotics Anonymous. Survival baffled the hospital staff and my family doctor. I believe that I'm alive and free today so that I can help someone else like me find the amazing truth, Narcotics Anonymous works. My recovery today is firmly based in the 12 steps and express through service. The steps provide a spiritual resolution to all my problems. Active service work helps ensure that there will always be a place for me to go when I need to share. When I am desperate and frightened, I need to share with other addicts who are seeking recovery. It was suggested to me that I start an NA meeting in my area. I was frightened and didn't think I had enough clean time. My friends told me that I could be miserable as long as I wanted to be. With the help of God and other addicts, that meeting began and continues to thrive. I want to keep what has been given to me, so I actively share through loving service to NA, wherever and however I am asked. The spirit of this fellowship is in me today. Than I was. I had stolen one of my mother's rings and I offered it to her. It seemed as if I was born with that sort of nature. She turned it down and I was heartbroken. I had been associated with alcohol when I was younger. My father was always letting me sip his beer. It made me feel grown up. This night was different. My feelings were hurt. I drank on my own. I enjoyed it. It made me feel good and it helped me to forget. It wasn't for another year that I became independently high. This time, it was beer and marijuana. I enjoyed the feeling that these substances gave me. I always felt inferior before, but now, under the influence, I felt superior to the people around me. I came from a broken home, and both of my adopted parents were alcoholic. I had been surrounded by drinking all of my life. When When I was 8, we moved to California. My mother had gotten together with a man who I hated. He treated me unfairly. He had caught me stealing and he never gave me a chance for amends. I felt neglected. I never had any friends and I was always lonely. I started smoking more marijuana and drinking more alcohol. I became involved in breaking and entering in a lot of fighting. This all gave me a feeling of superiority. My mother and I moved to Michigan when I was 13. I really felt like somebody there. I could smoke more marijuana than any of the hometown boys. I started growing my own pot. A short time later, I moved to Florida with my father. There, I started dealing barbiturates. I built up a large tolerance to them. They were not working as well as they used to. At age 16, I was working in a pool hall. I had quit school and left home. I was living on the streets. Even in the gutter, I felt superior. A lot. 195. 196 Narcotics Anonymous. Of runaways hung around this place known as the Scum Hole, and it was raided by the police at least once a day. Hookers, hustlers, and dealers made their living there. I was one of the leaders of this group. I became interested in cocaine and hallucinogens. As usual, I went overboard. I started pimping and dealing. I was looked up to by the runaways. I felt like I was it. There was no one better. We traveled in packs like wolves and we lived in pickup trucks. I remember going into stores in groups of 20 or 30 and doing our shopping without any money. We were the scum of the town. Many times I could pass for 18. I spent a lot of time in bars that caused periods of loss of memory and blackouts. Later I overdosed on barbiturates, but it didn't stop me. I started using more chemicals than my wallet could afford. I was offered a job breaking bones for a living. I accepted it on the spot. This was satisfactory for a while, but I started requiring more substance. My disease was still progressing. I hit my first and worst bottom when I started selling my body for drugs. I accommodated men as well as women. I would have accommodated lower orders if it had been necessary. I felt as if my life was not worth living. Many times I had strong suicidal feelings. My moral standards were shot. I felt defeated. Chemicals, marijuana and alcohol were worth more to me than my own life. I needed to sustain myself. One night I started thinking about what I was doing to myself. I couldn't handle it. Once again, I resorted to prostituting to obtain cocaine. A friend of mine pumped my veins full of it. Wow, I couldn't believe it. I was never so happy in my life. I was kicked out of the house where I had been living and was told that no junkie was wanted in this house. When I came down, I was really in trouble. I was in a deep depression. I was thinking about my near past and it made me nauseated. All I wanted was another fix and that really scared me. I was afraid of becoming a human pincushion. I had too many friends who were, so I hopped on the next plane to California. I thought I could start over. I was weary of drugs for a while and I couldn't get any. I didn't know anyone and I was very lonely. For about 5 months I turned to alcohol. I drank about one quart of alcohol per day. When I finally found a cocaine and acid connection, I started stealing for money to support my habit. My drug of choice was acid. I could not stop. I got a job at a donut shop and began stealing from $20 to $200 per day from the cash register. Every cent was spent on drugs. I took about 100 hits of acid a month for 2½ to 3 months. I couldn't live without it.
Being clean and having complete abstinence from all minor moods.
suggested. If he said jump, I asked how high. I was willing to go to any length. I did nothing but work my program. It was no bed of roses. In fact, some parts of my recovery were living hell. It was worth it. The picture started to come into focus once again. Things improved. I kept coming back to 199. With life in general, I have learned to live on life's terms. I also learned to live a day at a time. I did it the hard way, but today is what counts. It took me 6 months to grasp this remarkable recovery program. It took everything I did to get to where I am now. I enjoy my life now a day at a time. I can work the 12 steps of NA on any given situation at any given moment. I enjoy working with others and giving them the same chance that was given to me. I owe my life to the program of NA. I owe special thanks to the loving people that helped me and gave me a chance to become a new person with a new life. And the ultimate thanks to my higher power, God. 200 Narcotics Anonymous. IT won't get any worse. There were a lot of reasons why I first started using. I felt different from my peers. I went to a private school. The kids in private school wouldn't like me because I hung around with the kids on my street who went to public school. I was a misfit. The public school kids would pick on me, too. I couldn't leave the block, so I had to hang around with them. I grew up feeling different. I had a lot of fights with my parents because I felt very restricted. I really didn't like myself and I wanted to change so that the other kids wouldn't think I was cool. I was afraid of girls and thought they wouldn't like me. My first encounter with using was when I was about 12 or 13, with a bunch of girls who were upping blue. They were really friendly to me and asked me to join them. I didn't even have to think about it. I just did it. Huffing became very compulsive with me. I started doing it all the time, by myself and anywhere I wanted. I remember feeling guilty, thinking, God's watching me, and feeling wrong. All the guys on the block would drink on the weekends and I wanted to be a part of it, so I wanted to drink. I had to be in when it got dark, so I had to wait until my parents went somewhere on a Saturday. I wanted to be able to say that I got drunk, so I stole a little food from my father and drank the whole thing. I got really sick and did a lot of weird things in my neighborhood and everyone knew that I was drunk. I couldn't wait until I got to school the next day to see what all the kids would say. I didn't care that they thought I was a fool. It just felt really good to know that they were all talking about me. It enabled me to say things that I was afraid to, and whatever I wanted to, and I could say, well, I couldn't help it, I was drunk. Soon after, I started smoking dope and I loved it. I also remember the paranoia, thinking that God was going to strike me dead. I started smoking compulsively soon after I tried it. Dope made me feel really hip and like I had a lot of friends. I remember feeling that God was full and that I didn't need him. All I needed was to get up. I'm happy as well. took too much.